As we start Luke 16 this morning, much like last week, I wish we could cover the entire chapter in one sitting, but we just don't have enough time to do all of the text justice if we tried. So we're going to cover it over a couple weeks, but we're going to see there's definitely an interconnection between the first and second parts of chapter 16. In fact, Jesus has kept a theme alive now for several chapters, this theme of stewardship. Sometimes it's very clear and direct, sometimes it's underlying a little bit of some of the other teaching. For example, last Sunday we looked at the three parables, the lost sheep, the lost coin, and the lost son. And of course, the key was that what was lost was then found and there was celebration. But do you remember, in even looking at the lost son in particular, the prodigal son, what was the issue there? What showed his lostness? Was he took the inheritance early, and what did he do? He was a poor steward of it. He squandered it. He wasted it on prodigal living, reckless, wild living. Next week we're going to see, as Jesus gives us a little glimpse about what happens after death, another example of a rich man who ignores a poor man who is right there at his gate of his house and doesn't do anything to help him. And chapter 12, a few chapters back, Jesus taught about how we are to see ourselves as stewards, waiting for our master to return. We don't know when, but when he does, and he will return, we should be about the business of serving him as good stewards. So this theme of stewardship is all over the place in the last few chapters. And now as we come to chapter 16, we have a parable about a steward. This parable is commonly titled the parable of the unjust steward. However, there are many who title it the parable of the wise steward. So, well, that almost sounds like a contradiction, but as we get into it, you're going to see, no, there's really not a contradiction there. But this parable of Jesus is probably one of the most difficult and debated parables of anything he ever taught in the Gospels. So let's get into it. As we look at the problem that this steward of the parable is facing, verse 1 of chapter 16, and note that Jesus now is addressing his teaching to his disciples. Verse 1, he also said to his disciples, "There was a certain rich man who had a steward, and an accusation was brought to him that this man was wasting his goods. So he called him and said to him, 'What is this I hear about you? Give an account of your stewardship, for you can no longer be steward.'" So this rich man, and we're going to find out, the details tell us that this is a very rich man, has a steward. And to be a steward of such a wealthy individual would of itself be quite a high status in society. This guy's got a really neat job, and yet he has not been faithful in it. Now, we don't know exactly what was going on. We're told that report came to the master there that he was wasting his goods. So not necessarily stealing from him, but being wasteful. It's the same word used back in chapter 15 in the story of the prodigal son there, how he went and he wasted his possessions with that prodigal living. So there's definitely mismanagement. Maybe part of the mismanagement is allowing these great debts to accrue without collecting them in the first place. That would be poor management to allow them to grow and grow. But what is key as we get into this parable is to note this. The guy is definitely fired from his job. He's being told, turn in the books because you're gone. So on the one hand, he knows his immediate future is certain. I'm out of work. But, of course, what about the longer term future? That's unknown. What am I going to do now? And so let's look at the plan that the steward comes up with, verse 3. Then the steward said within himself, "What shall I do? For my master is taking the stewardship away from me. I cannot dig, I am ashamed to beg. I've resolved what to do, that when I'm put out of the stewardship, they may receive me into their houses." So he called every one of his master's debtors to him and said to the first, "How much do you owe my master?" And he said, 100 measures of oil. So he said to him, "Take your bill and sit down quickly and write 50. Then he said to another, "And how much do you owe?" So he said, 100 measures of wheat. He said to him, "Take your bill and write 80. So this is where it starts to get difficult. Let's see what we can clearly observe first. Notice it is a plan. Verses 3 and 4 there. The steward is doing this deliberately so he can be in the good favor of the master's debtors. Now, one thing we can see is that these are huge amounts of value that are owed. The oil would be the equivalent of 875 gallons. Of oil that this guy owes. If you put a dollar figure on that and you use the standard of an average day laborer's salary, you're talking about over 3 years worth of salary for a day laborer for that sort of oil. Now that also means, by the way, not only is the boss a very rich man, because how can people owe you that kind of money without it cramping your own lifestyle? I mean, when people owe you a certain amount, they say, "Hey, you got to pay me, man. I need it over here." But that obviously wasn't the case. But these guys must be pretty wealthy themselves to even run up that sort of a tab. You don't get that kind of line of credit if you don't have some wealth. And of course, that fits the whole story, doesn't it? Because the whole point is the steward is looking for others to take care of him once he's officially off the job. So these aren't some little tenant farmers just scraping by. They're not going to be able to help this guy in his future. These are pretty wealthy guys themselves. And so that's the desire. And I think it's fair to assume that there's more than just the two debtors. You know, based on verse 5, he called every one of his master's debtors to him. We have two examples, but I think it's fair to assume that there were more than two debtors, and each one got the same treatment. How much do you owe? Let's cut it down. How much do you owe? Let's cut it down. And he did that throughout. But that's where the question hits. What exactly did he do? And this is where all of the debate comes in. And there is a lot of debate, a lot of explanations about what exactly he's doing here in reducing what is owed. And three of the most common and significant explanations are the ones I'll give you. First, it's possible that, sort of like we read it straight through, he's just cutting the bills. He doesn't care what the master's owed, because he's getting fired. So he's just trying to ingratiate himself with these debtors. Hey, you owe 100? Let's just say you owe 50. That's a possibility. Now, one problem with that is that, as we're going to see in a little bit, the master praises the steward, which doesn't seem to be the normal reaction that I would have if a guy ripped me off like that. Plus, what's to keep the master from just turning around and say, "He had no authority to cut your bill. I want the whole thing." In which case, then again, the steward isn't going to be welcomed into the guy's home, is he? It's argued that, well, to save face in society, no real wealthy guy like that would want to come back and say, "Hey, don't listen to what my steward did for you. I really want the whole thing." But that's speculative, of course. But that's one option. Now, a second possibility is that what he's doing is he's eliminating the interest that was owed on the debt. And you see, here's the thing. Under the law of Moses, you weren't supposed to charge interest for your fellow Jews. But as we've seen many times, in the days of Jesus, the experts in the law had found plenty of ways to have loopholes to get around what the teaching of God's law was. And one of those ways that we know is that rather than charging interest officially, they would just throw the interest in to the amount of the loan. So it looked like this is what you owe, but we're including the interest in there. In which case, the steward is saying, let's remove the interest, and the interest would be different depending on the commodity involved. That's why we have different percentages. And in doing so, would actually be fulfilling the law, which forbid interest, and making his master actually look pretty good in the sight of people because he's not charging the interest, which he shouldn't do. That's a possibility. Now, the third possibility, somewhat similar to that last one, is that what he is doing is he's taking away his commissions that would be owed on the deal. Again, this was much like in our day when you have a celebrity athlete or movie star and they have that agent and the agent gets paid commissions based on the transactions and all that they do on behalf of them, that also is a possibility. Therefore, what he's doing there is he's not costing his master anything. But again, he's still putting himself in good favor with the different debtors, so he'll have a place to stay once he loses his job. Now, here's the thing, though. We don't really need to have a definitive answer as to which of those options works and is true. You may have a favorite among those, so be it. What matters is, what is this meant to teach? Remember, it's a parable. The purpose of a parable is to teach a simple, basic little truth, isn't it? We've said that over and over again. Jesus uses parables to teach this key truth. And so we don't need to know necessarily definitively what all the details mean, but we do want to know what is the teaching. And that is something we can agree upon and understand. To do that, we got to look to the next verse as we see the praise of the steward by the master. Verse 8. So the master commended the unjust steward because he had dealt shrewdly or wisely. It's not necessarily a sinister word there. It's a word commonly translated wisely. For the sons of this world are more shrewd or more wise in their generation than the sons of light. Now there's actually some debate whether the parable should be ended at verse 7, and verse 8 is actually Luke talking about the master Jesus. But I don't think that that's a strong argument at all. I think it's pretty clear that Jesus is still telling the parable halfway through verse 8. So the master commended the unjust steward because he had done wisely. And then Jesus is tacking on at the end the moral of the story, or as he would conclude it, for the sons of this world are more wise in their generation than the sons of light. We don't have to be thrown by the reference again to unjust steward here as connecting it to the actions that he just did. It just simply could be a reference to the introductory material. He's the unjust steward at the beginning. But what is the wisdom that he is showing here that got the praise from the master? And that's the key to the teaching, and that's what we need to understand. And it's actually pretty simple. The wisdom is this. He used his present opportunities, his present circumstances, to prepare for the future. That's it. That's a parable. Use your present opportunities, present circumstances, to prepare for the future, which you know is coming. Just like he knew he was going to be out of this job. Jesus makes the contrast, though, between the world and the children of God. The sons of light versus the sons of this world. Because the sons of this world, like this steward, they make those preparations. They're thinking about, well, we got to do this because in a few months and a year or so, and they're using their present circumstances to prepare for the future. But are the children of God doing that? Are we doing that? Of course, for us, as one, if you believe in Jesus Christ, trusting Him as your Savior, the word future has a little different meaning, doesn't it? Not talking about an earthly future at all, are we? A few days, weeks, months, years down the road, no. We're talking about the future kingdom, the coming of the Lord, when we will be with him, where we will reign and rule and live with him and forever and ever. So that's the future from our perspective. And what Jesus is saying is, there's not enough of us that are using our present opportunities, our present circumstances here in this life on this earth to properly prepare for that future. And that's what he would have us to do. And that leads us now to the purpose of him giving this parable in the first place, in verse 9. Verse 9 is the only direct instruction in the entire teaching. I mean, there's a lot of teaching here, but the only direct instruction, commands, here's what you do, found right here in verse 9. Let's look at it. And I say to you, make friends for yourselves by unrighteous mammon, that when you fail, or some translations, when it fails, they may receive you into an everlasting home. There's a textual debate as to which is proper, but it really doesn't matter because both speak to the same event. When you fail, meaning when you die, or when it, the unrighteous mammon, fails, which is also at your death. What good is money to you once you're dead? Amen? So it still refers to the same thing, so it's no big deal. So make friends for yourselves by the unrighteous mammon. Now, mammon, the word itself, isn't necessarily a negative, bad word. It derives from an Aramaic word, bringing it down, mammon, from the Aramaic. But Jesus adds a little something there when he calls it unrighteous mammon. It's his way of expressing worldly wealth. And of course, it sets up the contrast that he's trying to teach upon. So don't go too far. Don't think this is talking about money that you make by sinful activity or something like that, and therefore it's unrighteous mammon. No, but it's just the idea of worldly wealth. Use your wealth in this world to make friends for yourself so that when you die, you may be received into the everlasting home. Now, there's one more thing we need to unpack, though, and that's that word friends. Now, if you were here last Wednesday night, and if you weren't, where were you? We're going through 2 Corinthians on Wednesday night. And we mentioned, as Paul writes to the Corinthians there in 2 Corinthians about how God leads him in triumph. We said, as we read that today, we say triumph. I know what that word means. It means to conquer over and be victorious and all that. Sure. But Paul's writing in the first century in a certain society, a certain cultural context, and to his initial audience, the word triumph had a special meaning. It spoke to a Roman military parade, the highest honor the Roman emperor could bestow upon one of his generals. And so all the details there in 2 Corinthians around that word triumph speak to the details of this great military celebration, and we need to understand that to understand what Paul's truly teaching there. Well, that's the case here. You say, Steve, what's the challenge with the word friend? Everyone knows what the word friend means. But do we understand it from the first century time period and culture? And remember, Luke is writing to a Gentile audience. Roman free society was divided at this time by means of a system known as patronage. Again, we're not talking about slavery, which was very common in the Roman Empire. This is free society, but it was still very divided by this system of patronage, where you would have patrons and you would have clients. And you could actually be both. You could be the client to a patron, and yet then you could be a patron to a client. And the division was totally based on your net worth, your wealth. This is how society was divided. patrons had more money than clients. So a real wealthy guy, and you could be the client to him, but if you had some money yourself, you could be a patron to some guy who was poorer than you. This was a huge part of society. You see, there would be a mutual benefit. A patron, of course, would financially assist and support his clients. And it was a big societal thing to have a whole bunch of clients because it showed how wealthy you were to everybody. And so, for example, if your clients needed help with the law, as the patron, you would pay their legal bills. And there were other financial duties you would take upon yourself as their patron. The client would have responsibility as well. He would seek to serve the patron. Again, we're not talking about slavery. But for example, if the patron ran for office, I'm running for the Roman Senate, the client would have to vote for him. That sort of thing. Speaking of slavery, if a slave owner ever decided to release a slave, I'm going to free my slave, society turned it so that that slave automatically became a client and that slave owner was the patron and would financially support that slave going forward. Artists. No different than today. Awful hard for an artist to feed the family. Well, what would happen is, if you're a sculptor, you would have a patron who would be backing you, and he would help feed your family while you're doing your sculpture work. And then when you were finished, of course, what would you do? You would, in the name of the patron, dedicate your artwork. So again, if you're a rich patron, you got all these artists as your clients, you've got all these statues all over Rome that all have your name associated with them. Big status symbol. Okay. But there was another kind of relationship in this society. It was a relationship of financial equals. Remember, patronage is all about richer and poorer and who has more wealth. But what if you've got financial equals that form a partnership of sorts so they can mutually assist each other? But they're equals in society, financially speaking. Well, you know what those guys were called? Not patrons and clients. They were called friends. Friends. In Latin, amicus. We even today use amicus. Have you ever heard of an amicus brief? When a lawyer files an amicus brief, it speaks to being a friend of the court. The lawyer says, look, I'm not really one of the parties to this lawsuit, but as a friend of the court, I've got some opinions about what you're going to be dealing with, judge. I'd like to file an amicus brief. So we still use the term today, friend. So what is Jesus saying? Make friends for yourselves using your wealth. So use your wealth like a patron would to help someone who has less than you, but he throws out the relationship idea of that you're better than him because you're helping him. No, but you see him as an equal. Use your wealth to help those who have less than you, but you see them as your equal. And in doing so, you are properly preparing for your future heavenly reward. That's what he's teaching. And this is why in chapter 14, we saw Jesus when he was talking about when you throw a big supper, you don't invite all the rich people in the neighborhood, they're going to pay you back. You invite the poor, the blind, the lame. They can't pay you back. And what did he say? You'll be blessed because they can't pay you back, because you will be repaid at the resurrection of the just. And that's why he tells this parable. We should be thinking of our future and using our present circumstances and opportunities to prepare for the future, which speaks of the resurrection to come, not a future on this earth. And he closes now the next few verses with some principles here about stewardship. Verse 10. He who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much. And he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in much. Therefore, if you've not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, the worldly wealth, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And if you've not been faithful in what is another man's, who will give you what is your own? So these principles of stewardship from being a good steward of what is little, you become a steward of greater things. And although certainly we see money and possessions being an overall theme of all this, this has a broader application. You think of someone studying the Nazi Holocaust and what was going on in Europe as Hitler was rounding up all the Jews and sending them to the concentration camps to be killed. And you hear the stories of the occasional Christian with great courage and bravery working underground and defying those orders and trying to protect Jews and help them and keep them alive and all. And you think, yeah, boy, if I was living in those days, that would have been me. I would have been doing that. And if our country ever goes down that road, God forbid, I want to be one of those people that are taking a stand and risking my own life, risking myself being thrown in a concentration camp to fight against that evil. That's a very noble thought. But do we ever speak up against any sort of evil at all in the here and now? Guys, you ever at McDonald's and a bunch of high school kids are loud and cussing every other word, and here's some lady trying to have a nice lunch with her little 4-year-old, 5-year-old, and all this filth is filling the air. You go over to that table and you say, look guys, you're going to clean up your language or you're going to get out of here right now. There's little children around here. Well, I hate to cause problems and all that, but I'd stand up to the Nazis. How about sharing the gospel? We read about the great missionary works in Africa and Asia. I think, man, that just is so appealing. I just love to go there and plant churches and share the gospel to people who've never heard of Jesus and all that. And again, a very noble thought, but do you ever share the gospel here in your neighborhood? Locally? At work? There's nothing magical that happens when you get off the airplane and step on foreign soil. It's like, now I'm a great evangelist, you know? And of course, it's true with finances as well. We have those dreams. I wish I had an uncle somewhere I didn't even know of, but he was a millionaire. He just left me $1 million because I was the only heir left. And I could do so much good for Jesus with that big chunk of money like that. But if we're not faithful stewards of whatever amount we have now, no matter how small it is, if that did happen to you, just blow through it, waste it. Wouldn't all of a sudden become a great steward just because there's lots of it. You got to be faithful in the little things to be faithful in greater things. How about being faithful in what belongs to others? If you work for an employer, that's his time, isn't it? He's paying you, or she is paying you, to do the job. Some say, man, I wish I was self-employed. I could set my own hours and all that. You just flake out watching TV all the time if you're not faithful in the hours that are there before you that belong to someone else. Say, you know, I just rent, so I don't really have to worry about this property. Is that the Christian attitude? I'm just a renter, so it doesn't matter how bad this place gets trashed. Think you're going to be entrusted with your own place someday? What's your attitude towards things? See, principles of stewardship. And of course, Jesus closes now verse 13 with an absolute. No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he'll be loyal to one, despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Now, when we were talking about counting the cost of discipleship at the end of chapter 14, we dealt with this Jewish way of speaking using love and hate. When you're comparing two things and you're talking about preferring one over the other, it is very Jewish, very common to speak of loving one and hating the other. So again, it's not that you have an actual hatred towards your second master here, but the idea is you're going to always play favorites. You're going to pick one over the other. You can't faithfully serve two masters. It's impossible. You have to have an undivided loyalty to one. And that's how Jesus taught it in the counting the cost of discipleship. He says, your loyalty, your commitment to me has to be greater than even your earthly family. And so here now we see mammon is personalized, isn't it? You can't serve God and mammon and a personal master. And boy, there are a lot of people in this world who serve mammon and not God. And you certainly can't do both. And next week we're going to see an example, as I say, these tie together. We're going to see an example of what it looks like for a guy who serves mammon instead of God and ends up in hell when he dies. But again, that's for next week. So let's pray.